Hi, Dr. Bhaskar, how are you?
Fine, sir. How are you, sir?
I'm good.
Okay.
All set?
Yes.
Would you like to put your video on or you want to keep it off?
The camera?
Yeah.
Yes, I can now put it. No issues.
Oh, great. So we'll start. Are you ready?
Yes, I am ready. I can start.
Okay, just give me a minute, please.
Okay, sure, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. This is Pursue 13E, which is the pathology of head and neck. And we are streaming live from Kolkata, India. And the topic of the day is very interesting, solving jigsaw puzzles, the non-odontogenic lesions of the jaw. And to present that, we have Dr. Bhaskar Mitra, who is an MBBS from Calcutta, MD, DNB in pathology, a gold medalist. Presently, he is a consultant histopathologist in the famous Dr. Stubedi and Roy Diagnostic Laboratory, Kolkata. He has got multiple national and international publications. He had earlier served as an assistant professor in the Department of Pathology at MMC College and Hospital under the West Bengal education system. He is an advisor of clinical research at School of Medical Science and Technology, Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. He has got more than 20 publications in national and international journals. He is a reviewer of very many journals, including the International Journals of Surgical Case Reports, British Journal of Medicine and Medical Research, Journal of Cancer and Tumor International, Journal of Surgical Techniques Development, Journal of Applied Life Sciences International. And he's also a member of various international and national organizations. Before I ask him to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Bhaskar, please start. Thank you so much. Right, we can see your screen. Yeah. Just make it full screen and press that hide button so that just goes away. We'll just share your PowerPoint from below. Your PowerPoint.
Yes. Good afternoon. Good evening,
just
everybody.
Make it full screen. Just make it full screen.
Okay. I think I am audible and visible to everybody.
Yeah, you are audible, but we can't see your screen yet.
It's starting. Just. Yes.
Yeah, that's fine.
I think
fine.
Now
everything is fine. Yeah, please start. Thank you.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Today, my topic is on the different jaw lesions. Today, I am going to focus mainly on the non-odontogenic lesions. I coined the title of this today's class or today's lecture is like solving the jigsaw puzzles. Jigsaw puzzles is like that. We know all the pieces, but the challenge is how to fit it in a proper way. That is the thing. Same things in the cases of jaw lesions. Here, most of the things are like a jigsaw puzzle. Like we know there are fibrous tissue, there is bone, but how to fit in and name the individual pathological lesions is very important. And the fitting and the combination of different types of material is very important, and that is the clue how we'll approach this type of jaw lesions. First of all, a few words on the odontogenesis. Like that is, it is an enamel organ, dental papilla and dental follicles are there. This enamel is an epithelial structure mainly derived from the oral ectoderm. Dental papilla and the follicle are the ectomesenchymal in origin. So from this, there are two broad categories of the lesions. One is the odontogenic tumors, another is the non-odontogenic tumors. The formation of this or the odontogenesis starts at the 5th and 6th week of intrauterine life, and it continues till about 16 years. So what we get there, we get some portion of epithelium, ectomesenchymal elements, definitely in that bed of bone. So if there is a dysregulation in this odontogenesis, that will create the different lesions. The different lesions may be a hematometastasis lesion, there may be malformations, or there may be neoplasms. Collectively, we termed those as odontogenic lesions or tumors. Okay. These are mainly self-limiting lesions. Sometimes they are aggressive, may go to malignant transformation, and the surgical intervention is the most modality of treatment of choice in these cases. So, again back to the basics. In the jaw, what do you see? Epithelium and mesenchymal. In the epithelium, there are odontogenic epithelium and there are non-odontogenic epithelium, like surface epithelium, salivary gland, like these things. In the mesenchyme, we get the basic things like the fibrous tissue, bone, blood vessels, nerve. This same material we get everywhere in our body. So these are the pieces of this jigsaw puzzle. Okay. Now, so there is a combination of these things. Sometimes we get a cystic lesions. Sometimes we may get a fibrous lesion. Sometimes we get a bony lesion, sometimes we get an epithelial lesion, sometimes we get a lymphoid lesion in the jaw tissues. So this, from this name suggests how it derives and it is composed of what material. Now how to approach these things? So my approach to the jaw lesion is from the basics, particularly for the residents, I will suggest the jaw lesion. First, we have to understand what we are seeing, whether we are seeing a solid lesion or a cystic lesion. If it's a cyst, then is it a true cyst or it's a pseudocyst? We all know what is true cyst. The cyst lined by an epithelium.
for having a lining, definite lining. Cyst without any definite lining or epithelium is a pseudocyst. Now, if we don't see the cyst, whether we are seeing a solid lesion, is that solid lesion is hard or that solid lesion is soft? If it is a soft lesion, it may be a fibrous origin lesion, it may be a vascular lesion, it may be a neural lesion. Sometimes it may be a fatty lesion. Usually less common, but we may get those things. In case of hard lesions, these things are supposed to be made of either bone or cartilage. So on this, first approach, cyst or solid. Coming to the cyst, there are list of odontogenic cysts. There are list of non-odontogenic cysts. Among this, first this group is a true cysts. So first I will go one by one of this. The odontogenic lesion cyst, this will be covered by our fellow colleague in our subsequent lectures. So I will skip that odontogenic part. Now coming to the cyst. What I suggested, that the cyst is having a lesion, having a lumen, lined by, if it's lined by an epithelium, it's a true cyst, and surrounded by a fibrous capsule. Pseudocyst, absent of this lining, but lumen and the fibrous capsule is there. Now how it derives? The basic pathogenesis is, sometimes it develops from a cell rest. The cell rest starts proliferation, and the center part of this cell rest become having lack of nutrition, there is autolysis of the cells forming a cystic lesion. Sometimes there may be proliferation of this lining cells around a cystic cavity or anything. So that again causes a cyst. Small cyst may coalesce together and form a large cyst. Say, and sometimes this central area of this cell rest may get destroyed due to some immunogenic things, and that will again cause some cystic lesions. Now, if the cyst is non-epithelial line, then it would be a pseudocyst. Now, if it is an epithelial line cyst, again it can be derived into the two part. Either it may be of inflammatory origin, or it may be non-inflammatory developmental origin, where we may get odontogenic or non-odontogenic lining epithelium. Okay, this usually grows slowly. They are symptomless until and unless it gets infected. It's usually compressible and fluctuate. You sometimes grossly it appears clinically as a bluish lesion. Radiologically, this shows radiolucency, and if we aspirate this, it comes, fluid comes out from the cystic lesion. The transillumination test, sometimes we found it positive for the clinical aspect. Now coming to the first true cyst, that is a globular maxillary cystic lesion. Now, regarding the pathogenesis of this cystic lesion, initially it was thought that there is some cell nest lying within the fusion plates. After that epithelial entrapment causes loss of the cells and causing the cystic lesion. But now this theory is not there. They say there is a defect in a specific location. Globular cystic lesion is a fissural cyst located between the globular and the maxillary process. This causes this translucent. It is a location-wise lesion. This is not a histological diagnosis. It is a location-wise diagnosis. The histological diagnosis, it may be a periodontal cyst, it may be a central giant cell granuloma or odontogenic cyst like that of. Now, coming to the next cyst, is a nasolabial cyst. It is again a rare developmental cyst. In the upper lip, lateral to the midline, this occurs. Now, they causes radiolucent depression. Now, histologically, they show a typical characteristics. They usually line by non-ciliated stratified columnar epithelium at places. Numerous goblet cells are there, frequently in the epithelial lining. Fibrous capsule is relatively acellular, but sometimes if infected, may get infiltrated by the different inflammatory cells. Mucous glands, goblets may be present in the, within this fibrous capsule. So if we get a cyst in a area that is just around the lip and this areas with a pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium line with a different mucous glands and goblet cell, it's definitely a case of nasolabial cyst. Now again, median mandibular cyst. This is the location. Again, this is a mandibular cyst. This is a bony defect or translucency occurring a cystic lesion. Again, the theory was intactment of this epithelium, but sometimes some school of thought, they don't believe it. Again, the this is a location-wise, the name suggests. These lesions may be any odontogenic or non-odontogenic lesion. Now, coming to that nasopalatine cyst. It is a lesion due to the proliferation of the epithelial remnants paired with the embryonic mesopalatine ducts. The lining epithelium is mainly the pseudostratified squamous epithelium to the pseudostratified columnar epithelium. Sometimes there may be a mixture of these two. And the wall is again composed of fibrocollagenous tissue with a dense inflammatory infiltrate with a presence of neurovascular bundles in this cyst. So location, lining cell, epithelium and the inflammatory cell, this suggests this is a nasopalatine cyst. Here usually the mucous gland, goblet cells, these are lacking. Now coming to the pseudocysts. Pseudocysts, that is a cyst without the lining. We often encounter this aneurysmal bone cyst in the different bone lesions. Here the ABC is mainly from genesis of this due to any persistent alteration of the hemodynamics causes increased venous pressure in this area. Ultimately, that venous pressure causes resorption of the bone at that site. As because there is a resorption, so there is giant cell reaction, followed by there may be formation of the different connective tissue like osteoid, new bone formation is there. So, as per development, it can be divided into the four stages. That is, the first is the osteolytic by initial phase, followed by active growth phase where there is a rapid destruction of the bone and subposterior blowout pattern is there, followed by mature stage or stage of stabilization where there is a formation of a bony septa which gives a soap bubble appearance on the radiology. Next comes the healing phase where there is a calcification and ossification there in the ABC. This is a typical characteristic picture of ABC. This is a cystic lesion containing dilated venous sinusoids, cavernous sinusoidal blood filled spaces surrounded by fibrocollagenous cyst wall, no definite cyst lining. The cyst wall composed of different giant cell reaction, multinucleated giant cells. There may be hemosiderin pigments or osteoid formation at sites. These are the other pictures. This is blood-filled dilated places. There may be formation of this multinucleated giant cells. There may be metaplastic osteoid or even bone formation in this ABC area. These are the giant cells in the surrounding these vascular spaces. Next comes the solitary bone cyst. We also call this as a simple bone cyst. It's an empty fluid containing cavity within the bone. This is mainly due to the trauma to the bone causing intramedullary hemorrhage followed by organization failure in the organization of this hematoma, ultimately liquefaction of the this clot and forming this traumatic or solitary bone cyst. This cyst usually contains blood or serosanguineous serous fluid lined by bland fibroconnective tissue stroma. There may be fibrous proliferation or myxomatous proliferation of this cyst wall associated with hemorrhage and the hemosiderin containing pigmentation. Occasionally there may be scattered multinucleated giant cells. Usually blood-filled sinusoidal spaces are not seen in cases of solitary bone cyst. This is one of the important differentiating point with the ABC. These are the solitary bone cyst. This is a fibroconnective stroma and there is the cystic spaces with the formation of a presence of viable bone there. This is a traumatic simple bone cyst. Now coming to this one. This is called static bone cyst or Stefan's bone defect. Here in the radiology, we get a definite cystic lesion within the bone. But how this is formed? This is mainly due to the entrapment of the different salivary gland or any other soft tissue during the development of the mandible. So that causes this cystic appearance of this areas. Now, usually in the histomorphology, we get hyperplastic salivary gland tissue in this static bone cyst or Stefan's bone defects. So this again is cystic lesion. There may be focal osteoporotic bone marrow defect. It is usually uncommon and very asymptomatic lesion. Focal radiolucency may be seen in the areas of hematopoiesis, particularly in the angle of mandible and maxillary tuberosity. This is probably, somebody says, due to the following abnormal healing of the tooth extension processes, and there is focus of extramedullary hematopoiesis that becomes hyperplastic in the adult life, causing the defect in the different areas of the bone, particularly the mandible and maxilla, giving rise to cystic lesion. There may be one acquired type of cyst, that is a surgical ciliated cyst. This is a cystic structure resulting from a portion of sinus lining may get entrapped within the bone during the surgical procedure, particularly the tooth extraction or any fascio-maxillary surgical procedure. Here the fibrocollagenous cyst is lined by this typical respiratory type epithelium or sinus epithelium. At places there may be collapsed or compressed epithelial lining. If we see in the higher power, we can reveal at places this ciliated sinus lining epithelium. This is mainly due to any surgical procedure. This lining epithelium get entrapped within the cyst. Now I also try to mention there are some other common lesions which we encounter during this head neck regions. That is, one is the branchial cyst or lymphoepithelial cyst. Here we get epithelium followed by a dense lymphoid infiltrate in the cyst walls. We might get, it's particularly common more on the neck than in the jaw. We can get a dermoid cyst with a different proportion of admixture of epithelial mesenchymal and the neuroepithelial elements, skin elements. There are this different combination of germ cells, germ cell layers are there in this, giving rise to this dermoid cyst or maciocystic teratomas. There may be thyroglossal taxis. Again, this can be on the jaw level or most commonly in the neck. That is, the lining of this is due to epithelium, maybe squamous epithelium, and definitely there is a presence of thyroid tissue or thyroid follicles in the wall of this cyst, which is a very diagnostic point in the diagnosis of this thyroglossal taxis. Now, after the cystic lesions, the true and pseudo cyst, I am coming to this soft tissue lesions, particularly the soft lesions, what I said in the flowchart. So these are the huge group of lesions, starting with giant cell fibroma, EPU, Loewy pyogenic granuloma, different things. Now, among this, I will try to approach this as per different tissue types. First, and these are the mesenchymal, these are the particularly non-odontogenic cases which I will going to focus and discuss. And these are the odontogenic cases which I will not discuss in this lecture. So starting with, we always get these lesions, always we also get in the other parts of the body, but particularly in the oral and the this jaw regions or buccal mucosa and the jaw region, bone regions. Here we get the P lesions, which is very characteristic, like epulis, like pyogenic granuloma, peripheral ossifying fibromas, peripheral giant cell granulomas. These P lesions are very common in these areas. Other lesions like fibroblastic lesion, lipomatous lesion, neurogenic lesion, vascular and muscular lesion, they can all seen in the other parts of the body also. Now starting with the fibrous lesion or fibroblastic lesion. Starting with irritation fibroma. These are nothing but small, small exophytic nodules. They are formed in the our jaw regions due to chronic trauma. These usually we get in the excision specimen. Here, what we see, it's a dome-shaped polypoid lesion composed of subepithelial mass of dense connective tissue with the flattened reti ridges. The lining epithelium show usually flattened ridges. It can be ulcerated, it can be hyperkeratotic due to chronic irritation. And in the subepithelial fibrocollagenous tissue, there is a dense collagenous bundles with a scattered fibroblast. Usually inflammatory cells are less in this irritation fibromas until and unless secondarily infected. Next is giant cell fibroma. Again, small exophytic mass, particularly it's seen in the gingival part. Here, the lesion is mainly composed of small nodules of fibroconnective tissue with the lining epithelium showing hyperplastic thickening and elongation of the reti ridges. At places, there may be interconnecting reti ridges there. So, comparing to the irritational fibroma, here the reti ridges are flattened. Here, the reti ridges are downwards elongated and hyperplastic. In the fibrocollagenous stoma, in the previous one, we get a dense collagenous fibrocollagenous stoma. Here, we get a fibrocollagenous stoma with the presence of multinucleated giant cells. That's why we called it this as a giant cell fibroma. Okay. Now, epiphysis. In the first two, again, this is an exophytic mass. In the first two, the key point, what is that? No inflammation or less inflammation. Here, the first point is a exophytic nodular mass in the gingiva with alveolar mucosa with a dense inflammatory cell infiltrate. Here, the lining epithelium is hyperplastic. There may be elongation of this reti ridges, with sometimes there may be pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, and there may be ulceration and dense inflammatory infiltrate in these areas, particularly the lymphocyte plasma. Sometimes there may be metaplastic chondromatous element, that is a cartilage formation or bone formation is there. Okay, so this, when we get a inflamed nodule with a hyperplastic lining overlying and the beneath is dense inflammatory stoma, sometimes with associated with metaplastic bones and cartilage, we diagnose these cases as epiphysis. Now, pyogenic granuloma. The other name is the lobular capillary hemangioma. So, it's a hemangioma, capillary hemangioma, lobular. So, we get lobules of capillary proliferation. So, it's actually a vascular lesion. So, comparing to the previous one, this blood vessel proliferation may be there, but not in a lobular configuration. Here, the predominant component is the lobular capillary proliferation causing this lobular capillary hemangioma or pyogenic granulomas. Okay, it usually presents in the deeper connective tissues. Now, there is another lesion called peripheral ossifying fibroma. The name, the last word, fibroma. So, it's an exophytic nodule of fibrous connective tissue. The other word in front of the fibroma is ossifying. So there may be presence of metaplastic osseous tissue or cementosseous tissue. So when we get a fibrous proliferation with a cementosseifying material in a good amount, okay, followed by inflammatory infiltrate, usually less, usually more, but increased proliferative fibroblastic stoma around that with a fibroconnective tissue having vascular, increased vascularity, abundant amount of this cementoossifying material, we term this as a peripheral ossifying fibroma. Okay. Now, peripheral is giant cell granuloma. Again, there the giant cells. The key point is the giant cells. Here there is again exophytic nodular lesion, usually occurs in the teenagers and young females. There is a proliferation of plump spindle cells with clusters of multinucleated giant cells are there. It is highly vascular, presence of hemorrhage may be there, highly vascularity is there, and sometimes they show increased mitotic activity, and there is cluster of these giant cells, but the atypical mitosis is not there. So this is peripheral giant cell germ. Now let's combine all these three. We see a solid lesion. Now exophytic solid lesion. So what to look for first? Whether it is how it is made of what thing? First, whether it is made of fibroconnective tissue thing or not. If it is fibroconnective tissue thing, if it's the answer is yes, then look for the overlying epithelium. Is it flattened or hyperplastic? And see beneath whether it is vascularized or inflamed. If it is not inflamed, the overlying epithelium is flattened, then it is not inflamed, overlying epithelium is flattened, then go for this radiation fibro. If the overlying lesion is hyperplastic, no inflammation, go for giant cell fibroma. Here we also look for this giant cells here, fibroblastic giant cells there. Now if the lesion is vascular and inflamed, then and the lining epithelium is much hyperplastic, go for epiolysis. If giant cells are there, then whether this giant cells is abundant in amount, then we go for peripheral giant cell granuloma. Vascularity, if it has got a definite lobular configuration, go for pyogenic granuloma, that is the lobular capillary hemangioma. And if other metaplastic component like the cementitious material, dental elements, bones, these are things, go for peripheral ossifying fibroma. So these are the differential and approach to the soft fibroconnective lesions in the jaw regions. Okay. Next. The lesion may be lipomatous, though less common, but can be seen in this area. Usually buccal mucosa, they present as a submucosal nodule, composed of classical picture of clusters of mature adipocytes surrounded by thin fibrous tissue septa with a capillary, transgressing capillaries within this. So this is a classical picture of lipoma. When we cut this nodules and we get the lipomatous thing, we term this as a submucosal lipoma on the orofacial region. There may be, apart from this fibrous lesions, there may be slow-growing painful nodule, usually in the buccal mucosa. And this nodule is mainly composed of cellular fascicles of parallel fascicle of spindle cells. There may be alternate and hypo and hypercellular area, and characteristic, this compressed and elongated staghorn type granulocell. This is the key point. Cellular fibroblastic or cellular spindle cell proliferation along with this staghorn type of blood vessels go for the suspicion of solitary fibrous tumor. On histology, the diagnosis may not be confirmed, but this confirmation comes with this immunohistological stains, particularly the CD34, BCL2 and STAT6. This stains confirm this presence of this solitary fibrous tumor in this jaw regions. So the key point is a spindle cell proliferation with staghorn type of blood vessels, hypo and hypercellular area, variable areas showing this solitary fibrous tumor, SFT. Now coming to, so on up to this point we are mainly discussing on the a bit of lipomatous, but mostly on the fibroblastic lesions. Now this point we are discussing on the neurogenic lesions. So in the neurogenic lesions, first of all, we like the all soft tissue, we have to see the nerve cells or the nerve bundles or the neural elements there. They usually again present as a submucosal nodules. They composed of different distinct type of spindle cells, either in the form of Schwann cells and the perinodal fibroblasts. First comes the traumatic neuroma. Traumatic neuroma is a sub-epithelial well-circumscribed lesion composed of the Schwann cells, wavy character of the Schwann cells, along with the perineural fibroblasts. Now, these fascicles of Schwann cells are distinctive with a curved nuclei surrounded by this perineural fibroblast. There may be small neuronlets, maybe there. Okay. But this is a well-circumscribed lesion. This is a case of traumatic neuroma. Now, there may be palisaded, encapsulated neuroma. Again, submucosal neuron and well-circumscribed lesion. Here, the lobular subepithelial tumor composed of mostly intervening bundles of spindle cells with eosinophilic stoma, and they show a typical palisading arrangement of this nuclei. But palisading arrangement is there, but it does not form the Verruque bodies. Okay. So this is a mass of spindle-shaped Schwann cells with a definite nuclear palisading apices. But differentiated with the schwannoma is that schwannoma shows a typical Verruque bodies, and it may show antennae A and B areas, that is different hypo and hypercellular area. It mostly hypercellular everywhere. Now, again coming to the schwannoma, it is again a well-circumscribed lesion, consists of almost entirely of the Schwann cells, lying in a loose myxoid areas, alternate with the cellular areas. They form these Verruque bodies where there is a palisading Schwann cells nuclei around the central acellular eosinophilic core. Okay, this is the central eosinophilic core surrounded by this Schwann cells. This lesion is again ascending positive. Now, neurofibroma. Up to this previous three, that is the traumatic neuroma, palisaded neuroma, and the schwannoma, these lesions are well circumscribed. Now, neurofibroma usually a diffuse type of unencapsulated lesions. Here, there is a mixture of this fibroblast and spindle-shaped Schwann cells with a wavy pointed nucleus. They are diffuse type of lesion. Spindle cells are elongated, fusiform, and grow in different directions. Having a tapering ends, the entire nerve bundles may be there. There may be scattered muscles within these lesions. Ascending is again positive, so ascending will not help in this case. Now, first I will go to this definition. So, how to approach this neural lesion? First of all, again, look at the cells. How it looks? It just looks like a Schwann cells or spindle cells with a tapering end and fascicles of the spindle cells. So, you are dealing with a neural lesion. Now, when you confirm the spindle cells and Schwann cells, so you are confirmed we are dealing with a neural lesion. Now, go for the circumscription. Next one. Circumscription will show you which are the lesions. So first, if this is a circumscribed, well-encapsulated lesion, so your differential will remain with neuroma, palisaded neuroma, and schwannoma. Now, if we see the good amount of palisading things, then these two are the differential, that is the schwannoma and the palisaded neuroma. Verruque bodies are there, antennae, antennae media, schwannoma. Not there, only palisaded things, with a palisading neuroma. Here in the traumatic neuroma, you will get this small Schwann cells, the neural bundles, along with palisaded fibroblast around this nerve things. Now there can be another type of lesion, that is called granular cell lesion. Here we found the submucosal mass composed of epithelioid type large polygonal cells. It's again an encapsulated lesion with abundant eosinophilic granular cytoplasm and vesicular nuclei. The characteristic thing is that this granular cytoplasm. There may be pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia overlying in the overlying mucosa. And This is the cell character having this abundant eosinophilic granular cytoplasm with vesicular nucleus, and they again is asyndet positive. Some says these are the Schwann cell derived tube. So it also comes in the jigsaw puzzles. So not only the spindle and Schwann cell, you may get a granular cell. So again, the trick is the location of the lesion, type of cells, arrangement of the cells, and the typical characteristic like the Verruca bodies, circumscription, granular cells. These things will help in the diagnosis of this neural lesions of this jaw area. Now coming to the vascular lesions. First is the hemangioma. Hemangioma may most commonly here occurs the capillary hemangiomas. One we already previously discussed, the lobular capillary hemangioma. Sometimes there may be a simple hemangioma having a submucous bluish nodule which branches on the patient. Sometimes though clinical findings we less get in our requisition forms, but if we are lucky enough, clinician told us that this lesion branches on the patient, you will think of this as a hemangioma. There may be small capillary channels or maybe larger cavernous endothelial lined spaces filled with blood. This is the hemangioma in the area. Now, there is a characteristic thing that is a caliber persistent artery. What is this? This is again presents as the submucosal nodule in the lip, particularly in the adults. What are this? Then in the histology, we get a large thick wall artery in a superficial submucosal location. Normally, this large thick wall blood vessels are devoid in the submucosal location. They usually situated deep down. But sometimes if they persist in the submucosal location, they may present as a nodule. Here, we can feel the pulses because of this thick wall arteries. Now, histologically, we see a large thick wall, muscular wall of the artery just beneath the mucosal epithelium and the wall of the artery, and usually it appears as a single large thick wall artery. So this is another lesion, caliber persistent artery, usually seen in the oral areas. Now, intravascular papillary endothelial hyperplasia. First, this is a intravascular lesion. So again, there is a large vessel with a thrombus may be there, and there is a papillary configuration within this blood vessel composed of mainly endothelial cells and fibrous connective tissue. These endothelial cells are usually flattened and bland. They do not show malignant features, but they show exuberant papillary configuration or hyperplastic things occurring within a blood vessel. So again, the lesion is a single blood vessel with a proliferation of this endothelial cells in a papillary pattern within this blood vessels. This is another lesion called traumatic ulcerative granuloma with stromal eosinophilia or TUCSI. Sometimes commonly we call it a bite ulcers. Okay, this is a chronic ulcer due to crushed stoma that can be clinically mistaken for ulcerative squamous cell carcinoma because of this proliferation of the cell. Coming to that later. But this is an ulcerated lesion with a dense cellular proliferation and numerous small vascular granulation tissue-like proliferation. Here in the stroma, there is an excess amount of inflammatory cell infiltrate with presence of numerous eosinophils. And the prominent infiltrate is the eosinophils. So there is an ulcer, inflammatory stromal infiltrate with a predominance of eosinophils. Ulcer, inflammatory stromal infiltrate, and eosinophilia. So this is the characteristic cardinal signs of this traumatic ulcerative granuloma with stromal eosinophilia or TUCSI. Now coming to a more aggressive lesion, Kaposi sarcoma. Here again it's a vascular lesion, and this tumor is composed of fascicles of spindle separate cells with abundant hemorrhage in the stroma. So there is the prominence of the spindle cells. This is a closely packed spindle cells, and we can see the extravasated RBC within this atypical spindle cells. There may be slit-like vascular structures within these lesions. There may be hemorrhage and deposits within this lesion. Some tumor shows, these cells show atypia or increased mitosis, and characteristically on immunohistochemistry, they are HHBA antigen antibody positives. So this is the Kaposi sarcoma. Now, like hemangioma, there may be lymphatic proliferation of the lymphatic blood vessels. There may be lymph-filled endothelial line channels in the submucosa forming this lymphangioma. They are usually poorly circumscribed lesions and filled with eosinophilic lymph material, usually devoid of RBC. This is the lymphangioma. Now, coming to the differential. Now, how will you approach? Again, the approach part. First, look if first what you see, fibroconnective tissue or neural tissue or blood vessels. If it is blood vessels, now first determine number of blood vessels, single blood vessels or multiple blood vessels. If you are seeing single blood vessels, then you go for this. Then you see the wall of the blood vessels. If it is a thick wall, thick caliber, thick wall blood vessels, single blood vessel in the submucosa, persistent caliber, persistent artery. If it is a single blood vessels with prominence of endothelial cells forming papillary hyperplasia, intravascular papillary hyperplasia. Okay. If it's multiple blood vessels, look what it contains. Is it blood? Go for hemangioma. Single endothelial line, no hyperplasia, no atypia. If it is contains lymph, it is lymphangioma. If it is blood, contains, it is hemangioma. Now coming to the, so next clue is the endothelial lining cells. Now next is the stroma. What do you see in the stroma? Is it stroma is proliferated of the stroma or increased stromal cellularity due to the inflammatory cells? Look for the presence of eosinophil or mixed inflammatory. If it is a mixed inflammatory cells with the predominance of eosinophils, it would be true. Go for the history of this traumatic injury in this area, usually positive. Or there may be stromal spindle cell proliferation with extramedial of RBC. So your differential will go focus onto the Kaposi. Now there is another lesion that is called vascular leiomyoma or angioleiomyoma. There is a proliferation or nodule formation or formation of a tumor due to proliferation of this vessel wall. That is a smooth muscle of the vessel wall get enlarged and forms this tumor. So there is a large submucosal nodules of smooth muscle containing irregular numerous thick wall blood vessels. Here the tumor, the spindle cells or this muscular spindle cell usually diffuses or admixed with the vessel wall. You cannot differentiate the blood vessel wall from this tumor cells. So actually the tumor arises from this vessel wall, so you cannot differentiate this. Usually they are well-defined, nodular proliferation of thick wall blood vessels with attached nest of spindle cells around it. They usually are smooth muscle actin, MSA, these are things positive, this means that is the muscle markers positive. So it again comes into the differential of this blood vessels. Here, the blood vessel, number of blood vessels more, but the wall are thick and the diffuses with the tumor. So these four are the key points which will help you to put the jigsaw puzzles into the proper areas. Okay, so this key points for the vascular lesions. Now, there may be submucosal proliferation of this nodule formation due to presence of myofibroblastic cells. Usually they are well circumscribed lesions composed of fascicles of spindle cells surrounded by irregular shaped endothelial line vascular spaces in between. Okay, there may be small chink-like blood vessels. The spindle cells usually have elongated hyperchromatic nuclei, bipolar nuclei resembling the myofibroblasts with moderate amount of eosinophilic cytoplasm. irregular stagnant shaped blood vessels may be there. The extravasation of RBC, these things usually not seen. Their spindle cells may show the proliferation and mitosis, but atypical mitosis is usually not there. These lesions are the myofibromas, and on immunohistochemistry they are usually SMA positive but negative for desmin, because this is a myofibroma, not a muscle tumor. Okay, so SMA is positive and S100 is negative. Now coming to the malignant part of this smooth muscle or this thing, that is the leiomyosarcoma. Here there is the infiltrating fascicles of spindle cells in a different fascicles, having a blunt nuclei and abundant amount of necrosis and mitotic activity. Atypical mitosis may be there. We can see readily see this mitotic figures in cases of this leiomyosarcomas. So up to this, we discussed about the soft solid lesions. So soft solid lesions means, I am just going back to my previous one of the slides. Just
hello.
Yes, sir. Just going back to my one of the previous slides.
Okay.
Yes. So this part. Okay. So jaw lesion cyst and the soft part. This is the fibrous part, where we can see the different fibrous tissue, lining epithelium, presence of giant cells, inflammatory cells, vascular things we discussed, neural things. Now we are going to this hard part, that is the bone and cartilage part. So for this, solving this jigsaw puzzles, we have to focus on those important points which we have discussed. Now going back to my normal slide. Okay, this is the heart bony lesions, particularly both cartilaginous and the bony lesions. Now among this, most important is the fibro-osseous lesions. So in the fibro-osseous lesions, again what we see, fibro and the osseous component in different variable admixtures. There are four main differential diagnoses. One is fibrous dysplasia or cemento-osseous dysplasia. Another is ossifying fibroma. Another is a juvenile trabecular ossifying fibroma. So one group is dysplasia, fibrous dysplasia, and one group is fibroma. So first of all, I have to think about this genesis, fibroma. So it's actually a spindle cell fibrous lesion ossifying, so it contains the bony part or the osseous part. So what we will get in these lesions, this ossifying fibroma and this group, is a proliferation of spindle cells along with osseous lesions. And here is the dysplasia of the fibrous component. So the development of this bone and fibrous configuration is disturbed. So what we'll see in this part, we see the mishapen but ill-formed bony trabeculae or different cemento-osseous materials, as this is a distorted or dysplastic growth of this thing. And here it is mainly a fibrous proliferation. Now, as this is a dysplastic or distorted thing, the lesion usually radiologically is not well circumscribed. They usually blend with the adjacent structures. I will discuss it differently, but here I will try to discuss the difference on that. Here we found the monotonous pattern of trabeculae lacking the different osteoblastic rimming. Cemento-osseous dysplasia fibroma, here this is only the fibrous part or oven bones are there. Here maybe we form fully formed osseous material. Okay. Now, ossifying fibroma, it's a fibrous tissue proliferation along with the osseous component. So these are radiologically well-defined radial lesions. Sometimes they may be radiopaque, but variable, these lesions are very much well-defined. There are variable amount of a cellular fibrous connective tissue stoma containing variable quantities of this osseous or fibrous material. Now, first coming to the ossifying fibroma, it is a benign neoplasm, most common in the mandible maxilla, third and fourth decades of life, it a bit aged, it's a well-circumscribed lesions. Okay, well-circumscribed lesion. Here we see the cellular fibrous tissue everywhere. Mostly the cellular fibrous tissue, it may be hypercellular area, or it may be hypocellular or myxoid areas containing this bony areas or cemento-osseous areas. Here, there is a abundant bony areas along with this cellular spindle cells areas. Okay, so main component is the fibrous proliferation. And there are this cemento-osseous materials are there. This is cemento-ossifying fibroma. Cemento-ossifying fibroma. Next is the juvenile trabecular ossifying fibroma. Here the name suggests this is a juvenile lesion, so it occurs in the younger age group. More common localized bony lesion, but again it's a well-defined lesion with a mixed radiolucent and opaque deficiency. These are well-demarcated tumor composed of trabeculae of oven bone rimmed by plumbed osteoblasts. Osteoblastic rimming are there in good amount, with a proliferation of this spindle cell stromal component. Okay, there is abundant cellular fibrous stromal proliferation. There may be hemorrhage at different places with a capillary vascularity at places. Usually this occurs in the subepithelial region, the sinus epithelium may be covering this there and there may be formation of this bridging islands of oven bones. Now coming to the fibrous dysplasia, as the name suggests, this is a dysplastic or disorganized growth. Here there is a Chinese letter, what we call, this is the C-shaped Chinese letter or disorganized oven bones formation. They again lying in a fibrous stoma, but this characteristic different size and shaped oven bones are there. They usually lack the typical osteoblastic rimming. And there may be plump fibroblast in the stoma, but this fibroblastic cellular stoma doesn't show any mitotic activity or pleomorphisms or any signs of malignancy. There may be metaplastic bony trabeculae may be there at some places. Occasionally, as there is a resorption of these bones are there, osteoclastic activity or scattered multinucleated giant cells, osteoclastic giant cells can be seen in the fibrous dysplasia. Now coming to the cemento-osseous dysplasia, here we can see the cementum-like material or there may be broad trabeculae or osseous material in a fibrocollagenous tissue. Here this is a fibrocollagenous tissue varying amount of cemento-osseous trabeculae. There may be retraction artifact because this is a soft tissue in the bone, there may be retraction artifact among this cement-ossifying material from the surrounding stone. There may be calcified areas in the different areas with presence of oven bone formation may be there. Again, this is a less ill-defined or dispersed type of lesion in the radiology. Now, if we don't see the fibrous part, only the bones, that is composed of primarily dense, compact bone with broad trabeculae. Mature bone within the possessive fibrous stoma. Then we cut off the fibrous part, we term this as an osteoma. Now they usually are composed of mature, trabeculae thick bones, as mature bones. Osteoblastic rimming is there, but less commonly seen, mostly thick bones. If we are seeing this thick trabeculae of bones everywhere, with a lining proliferation of osteoblast and in a good amount, then we have to think of this osteoblastomas. They are mixed radiolucent and well circumscribed lesions with an abundant amount of proliferation of this osteoblast. Sometimes this osteoblastic proliferation is so much, that is a huge amount, so we may term it as an aggressive osteoblastomas. But the mitotic activity, atypical mitosis, nuclear atypia is less common. If it comes, then we have to think of the osteosarcoma. Okay. So there are delicate woven bones with a numerous amount of osteoblast in their lining. Now, next stage is the osteosarcoma, where this osteoblast shows the malignant lung with presence of malignant osteoid formation. This osteosarcoma shows the huge amount of nuclear pleomorphism, nuclear atypia at places. It may be chondroblastic in nature, showing cartilaginous differentiation. Sometimes it may show a fibrous sarcoma-like areas, that is a fibroblastic type of osteosarcoma. Everything they contain this atypical osteoid, that is called the malignant osteoid, that is a leafy bones, is there in this osteosarcoma cases. Okay, so osteoma, osteoblastoma, aggressive osteoblastoma, osteosarcoma. This is the osteoproducing part. And first we have discussed the fibrosis part. Now, there is a distinct lesion we see in the jaw bones, that is the central giant cell granuloma. It's an asymptomatic, large, painful swelling. It may be unilocular or multilocular. This is a cellular fibrous connective tissue containing plump spindle cells with many clusters of multinucleated giant cells. So it's a giant cell containing lesions. Okay. And surrounding stroma shows hemorrhage. Now, comparing with the central giant cell granuloma with the giant cell tumor usually shows diffuse arrangement of this giant cells and proliferation of this stromal cells, which is lacking here. It is mainly the giant cells in clusters. Okay, but there is a bland type of stroma with areas of hemorrhage. Similar type of picture can be seen in cases of brown tumors of the jaw, where we can see this similar type of giant cell containing lesions with a bland stroma. The difference with the central giant cell granuloma and the hyperparathyroid, that is the brown tumor, is that metabolic changes of parathyroid hormone level. Here, the parathyroid hormone levels are very high. Central giant cell granuloma, this parathyroid hormone levels are usually normal. This is the brown tumor of hyperparathyroidism. Again, this is a giant cell containing lesions with a bland stroma with areas of hemorrhage. So the metabolic changes is most important in this brown tumors. So if we consider the giant cell lesion, containing lesion, this is a hyperparathyroidism one area, central giant cell granuloma one area, giant cell tumor or osteoclastoma. There may be aneurysmal bone cells which may contain these giant cells, or there may be giant cell like other giant cell, multinucleated giant cells or spindle shaped fibroblastic proliferation is there. Here I want to highlight for particularly the postgraduate, sometimes they encounter what is the difference between the peripheral giant cell lesions and the central giant cell granulomas. Peripheral giant cell granulomas usually are soft tissue extraosseous lesions occurring in the gingiva and the alveolar regions. Central giant cell granulomas are mainly the intraosseous lesions. Both contains the giant cells. They are little aggressive. These are more aggressive and a high recurrence rate. Morphology almost similar in the both of the cases. Peripheral giant cell granulomas, they are particularly the exophytic slow growing lesions, and these are the endophytic rapidly growing lesions. Bone resorption and the dental root resorption is more common in this central giant cell lesions. So again solving the jigsaw puzzles, what you will see? Bone, cementum. And what is the stroma? If you see a fibroblastic stroma containing bone or cementum like material, we term it as either, if it is bone ossifying fibroma, with a cementum is a cement ossifying fibroma. Now coming to the, if it is only bone, bone and bone everywhere, no, if it is oven bone, that is a disorderly organized oven bones are there, in a spindle cell stroma, we have to look for whether this contains any osteoblastic lining around this oven bones. If it is with osteoblastic lining, then osteofibrous dysplasia. Without osteoblastic lining, then it is fibrous dysplasia. Now coming to the bones, one is osteoma. Now look for the osteoblastic lining and atypia. If it is numerous osteoblast lining this areas, then we have to think of osteoblastoma. If there is a malignant osteoporation with presence of severe amount of atypia, then we have to think of osteosarcomas. Now coming to the giant cell containing lesion, hyperparathyroid hormone, the brown tumor is important. We have to look for this metabolic levels of this parathyroid hormone. Next, the important differentiating area to look for is the stromal cells. The stromal cells will signify, if it is a proliferated stromal cell, we have to think of a giant cell tumor and the arrangement of this giant cells, whether it is a loculated arrangement or diffuse, that will differentiate this central giant cell lesions along from the giant cell tumors of the bone or osteoclastomas. So these are the thing: abundant amount of osteoblast, osteoblastoma, osteosarcoma lining, fibrous dysplasia, cementosus dysplasia, and these are the fibrosis. These are the mainly the fibrosis lesions, and these are the mainly the bone-forming lesions. Now, if we get a cartilaginous cap on a bony lesion, we all know we are dealing with an osteochondroma or an exostosis. Okay. This is an osseous protuberance with a normal conical and the medullary cavity. That is, a cap is mainly from this hyaline cartilage. Endochondral goat plate like this cartilage is there. Beneath it, there is a bony trabeculae. So this is the osteochondroma. Sometimes we get in the mandibular regions, mandibular condyles is the most important thing. There may be synovial chondromatosis, that is, particularly in the jaw regions, we get small loose bodies like radiopaque nodules in the temporomandibular joint spaces. These are the small nodules of hyaline cartilage exhibiting enlarged and binucleated chondrocyte. Sometimes a small bit of atypia may be there into this chondrocytes due to the chronic irritation of this joint spaces, but usually atypical mitosis, increased mitotic activity, necrosis is not there. They mainly present as a small loose bodies. This is the synovial chondromatosis, particularly found in the temporomandibular joint spaces. There may be proliferation of these cartilaginous lesions. There may be lobules of cartilage with increased cellularity, atypia, and the mitotic activity. This will lead to the chondrosarcoma. These are the cellular lobules of cartilaginous tissue. And the nuclei of the chondrocytes are enlarged, hypochromatic, and atypical. The stroma may be mixed at places. Okay. We have to differentiate this chondrosarcomas from the osteosarcomas, where we get the malignant osteoid. Usually in the chondrosarcomas, we don't get this malignant osteoid. So these are the cartilaginous lesions, osteochondroma, synovial chondromatosis, and chondrosarcoma commonly found in cases of jaw lesions. Okay, osteochondroma, synovial chondromatosis, and this is the chondrosarcoma, and this is the osteosarcoma. Okay, where we have to differentiate it with this malignant osteoid there. Now, this thing we sometimes encounter in the jaw bones. Usually less common, but jaw bones may show metastatic tumors. This metastatic mainly comes from the breast, lung, prostate, kidney or colon. there may be metastatic melanoma in this jaw areas. The metastatic lesions are there. This is the metastatic melanoma in the jaw bones, which causing the radiolucency. There may be metastatic renal cell carcinoma in the jaw bones, and not we have to don't have to forget this lesions, that is the sheets of plasma cells may form the plasma cytoma in the jaw areas, which is very common. Here we can see the sheets of plasma cells. These are monoclonal plasma cells. They may show the light chain restriction, kappa or lambda light chain restriction in this local areas, giving rise to the localized plasma cytoma groups. There may be Langerhans cell histiocytosis, another uncommon but lesion can be seen in this jaw regions. Here, as we know, the characteristic morphological Langerhans cells with this group nuclei and presence of numerous eosinophils can be seen in this jaw bones. These are rare but uncommon lesions we may encounter in this jaw bones, bone lesions. Now, after this fibrous neural bony lesions, we rest with this lymphoid lesions. There may be lymphoid hyperplasia in these areas, lymphoepithelial cyst as we already discussed, or there may be neoplasm like lymphomas, plasmacytomas, or the granulocytic sarcomas. Hodgkin's lymphoma, most commonly we found the non-Hodgkin lymphomas. Hodgkin lymphomas rare but can be found in the jaw area, very rare. This is the reactive lymphoid hyperplasia. Okay, this is here we can see in this lymphoid proliferation, there is a exophytic mass, particularly the submucosal location with abundant lymphoid tissue. Here we can see the germinal centers. Okay, so this is like a reactive lymph node. We may see the reactive germinal centers in this submucosal location causing this reactive lymphoid hyperplasia, and there may be mixture of different type of lymphoid cells into this, that is the small lymphoid cells, plasma cells, histiocytes in this reactive proliferation. But when goes into the neoplastic proliferation, it is a monotonous proliferation, it may be small cell. Usually in the jaw bones, we get this aggressive lymphomas like DLB cells or Burkitt lymphomas. This shows the Burkitt lymphoma, intermediate size cells with a characteristic starry sky appearance and very aggressive lesions. We can see in this jaw bones, in jaw regions of the patients. There may be DLB cells. This is a large lymphoid cells, sheets of large lymphoid cells, monotonous proliferation. Cells shows much atypia and increased mitotic activity everywhere. Sometimes low grade lymphomas like Malt lymphomas can occur due to association of this sinus A regions. There may be low grade lymphomas by NHLs can present in this jaw regions also in association with sinus areas. So regarding the malignancies, there may be bony malignancies, different type of osteosarcoma, chondrosarcomas, Ewing sarcomas may be there, Burkitt's lymphoma, one of the aggressive plasma cell neoplasm, multiple myeloma, and the metastatic tumors are the most common malignant jaw lesions we can encounter other than those non-odontogenic, other than those these are mainly the non-odontogenic malignant lesions. Now, a small few important things about the inflammatory jaw lesions. Here, first of all, it is the dental pulp infection or pulpitis. It is a small periapical abscess, particularly in the non-vital pulp, that may lead to the periapical abscess formation, leading to the sinus tract formation. Or sometimes if the chronicity, they develop the chronic inflammation, regeneration repair and granuloma, ultimately they may form a periapical cyst. There may be associated necrosis and inflammation there. Sometimes this pulp infection may infect laterally those bones, giving rise to acute osteomyelitis. Here we can see the purulent exudate occupying this different marrow areas, that is the trabeculae of bone, sometimes with a dense neutrophilic infiltrate. dead bone sequestrum may be seen in this acute osteomyelitis cases. If it goes for a long period, it may comes with the chronic osteomyelitis with the presence of plasma cells and everything. There may be bone resorption leading to formation of these giant cells and associated fibrosis is there. Why I am discussing this chronic osteomyelitis? Sometimes the chronic osteomyelitis or chronic osteosis, presence of this fibrous tissue, osteoclastic giant cell and the resorptive bones, it may comes in the differential diagnosis of different fibrous lesion. We have to think very carefully. The radiology is always helpful in these cases, and the inflammatory areas and the other fibroconnective tissue histological findings is more important here, which is most commonly seen in cases of fibrosis lesions. Here the inflammatory part is much more. Now one distinctive entity in the jaw regions is the chronic osteomyelitis with proliferative periosteitis. This is nothing but a osteomyelitis with a prominent periosteal inflammatory reaction. Here the periosteal inflammatory reaction as is there, so there is perpendicular proliferation of this woven bones to resting normal reactive bones. This in the low power we can see this perpendicular arrangement of this new bones due to this periosteal reactions. This causes this characteristic woven bones with surrounding fibrous proliferation. This is also called the Garay's osteomyelitis. Here the marrow spaces in between the bone is mostly occupied by this fibrous tissue proliferation. There may be scattered inflammatory cells, but this pattern of proliferation of woven bone and fibrous tissue is most common here. This is again this proliferative periosteitis. Now, there may be long-term biphosphonate-associated osteonecrosis. You know, microtes in different areas. This is long-term biphosphonate application may lead to this formations of this necrotic tissues along with inflammatory infiltrate. This is particularly common in tech section during different jaw surgery, long-standing metastatic breast carcinoma patients. They may show this type of areas. And the two things, that is a diffuse sclerosing osteomyelitis. Here in the jaw, we may see this diffuse type of radiopacity due to long-standing osteomyelitis due to low virulent microorganism causing this fibrous tissue proliferation. There may be irregular bony trabeculae of different shape lined by osteoblast and along with this fibroblastic proliferation. This is a diffuse, mainly involving a large area of the jaw bones. Sometimes this may be very focal in the root of the teeth areas. Here we can see focally the proliferation of this radiopaque areas. And there may microscopically, there is a composed of masses of dense sclerotic bones and the less amount of connective tissue with a less inflammatory infiltrate in a particular location of this, particularly tip of the jaws. So coming into this, first of all, that is the, what is the take home message regarding this diagnostic approach? We have to see the clinics, we have to think of this radiology. And then comes to the histological difference. The approach of cystic and solid part is always helpful, and knowledge of this individual lesions and its characteristic pattern always helps to differentiate these lesions in this case. So help of radiology in one hand, with the histological knowledge in the other hand, we always can put the right pieces in the appropriate area of this jigsaw process to solve this non-odontogenic lesions. These are my references, and thank you all for this attention and hearing this.
Thank you, Dr. Oscar. Wonderfully done. A very tricky area, very difficult at times, not because of the basic nature of histology, but probably because of the lack of orientation and association of the substance of diagnosis, which makes it more difficult. And you rightly have chosen the right title. It's actually a jigsaw puzzle. And if you do not put your things in the right place, you'll be just going round and round without coming to a proper diagnosis. And there are very subtle changes between one lesion and the other. And especially the one that you spoke the last, the Garry's disease, it's very difficult to diagnose. It's not an easy thing to diagnose. And it can really mimic a lot of odontogenic lesions.
Particularly those fibrosis lesions, it's very difficult.
And one really needs to know the radiology and the clinics to really pick these things up. And you have really approached it very systematically, very nicely. And it has made things much simpler for everybody to understand. After hearing the whole lecture, now I know that I can diagnose many of it. Wonderfully done.
You already can diagnose many of it.
No, you have done a wonderful job. I am telling you, wonderful. And the way you have approached it, it means that you have really spent a lot of time trying to understand the subject. Because if you do not understand the subject, you cannot present it so well. Wonderfully done. Congratulations, Dr. Bhaskar.
Thank you.
Please share the PDF of this. It will be very important for the students everywhere across who would like to go through it. Right? Yeah. Thank you so much. Take care. Good night. Bye-bye. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. God bless you. Bye.
Bye.